Perhaps this has been one of those weeks where you have forgotten how to love, and I have those weeks all the time. May we be refreshed sitting at the feet of Jesus today. We come to church not because we are perfect or because we want something, but because Jesus is crazy about us. Turn to your neighbor and say, Jesus loves you. It's true. And don't let that be a petty statement. Those words have changed nations. They've changed history. And they should be changing our city today too. When you learn that you're truly loved by the God of the universe, all things are possible with God. Today's topic is a preparation message for the series that we're diving into starting this coming Monday. That's Monday, the 3rd of October. And it's all about this journey called Secrets of Prophecy. So every now and then, Seventh-day Adventist churches will stop in the regular moments of ministry and have a time where we dive into the Bible for a condensed season. So for the whole month of October, every Monday night, Wednesday night, and Friday night at 7 p.m., we will be here diving into God's Word. And if there's anything that helps us to truly commit to God, it's the Bible. It's the living pages. So I first appeal to our church family at large that if you know someone who's searching for answers right now, or someone who just needs help, come and bring them along. The greatest form of advertising is not maximizing our graphics on billboards or putting inserts into every letterbox. It's a personal and guided invitation from someone else. So why don't you be that person who God will bring? So I just ask us to commit to this. Come along, bring people along, and let's let God bless us in the process. Secondly, there may be some of us here who have enjoyed being a part of Royal Oak only in the recent months or this year, and you're wondering what this is all about, how you can find a deeper commitment. I encourage you to come along. You'll learn about what Seventh-day Christians really believe, why we do what we do, but more importantly, where we're going, what we're preparing for. So come along, be part of the journey. As a result of the month, we'll have a baptism on the final Sabbath of this month, so it'll be a special time where we can truly just give our church back to the Lord. This afternoon, just a final added promo here, we will be letterboxing these in our immediate community. So after lunch, what greater way to work off the carbs and the sugar than to go walk in the Lord's name. So if you're interested and if the weather's good, come and be in here at 2 o'clock and we'll separate for a brief time of letterboxing. Today's message is all about how we can prepare for this coming month. And there are three words which changed Solomon's reign as king. If my people. Solomon had learnt the secret of truly committing to God. And while he had a lot of junk and rough edges, the secret was this, that we need to give everything over to Jesus. That includes our friendships. That includes our finances. That includes all of our possessions. That includes the doubts that we have too and all of the emotional junk we seem to carry. If my people. So after God had revealed himself by fire to Solomon, he made a promise, and that's found in 2 Chronicles chapter 7. Before we turn there and before we pray, I just want to share a statement here which is written for us. A revival of true godliness among us is the greatest and most urgent of all of our needs. We need to see Jesus in us, and that only happens when we are revived, when God's Spirit fills, breaks, molds us again. To seek this should be our first work. Secondly, a revival need be expected only in answer to prayer. So you cannot come to church and expect revival to happen. We have to be committed to prayer. Some call it kneology, where you're learning how to kneel before Jesus. So I really do thank those who have come along to support the 10 days of prayer. We've had a wonderful time. The Holy Spirit has touched and rebuked and convicted us in big ways, but we want it to continue. So let's be a people of prayer. And on that note, let's pray. Mighty God, today we thank you for leading us this week. Thank you for giving us a church like this. And we only ask now, what would you have us learn from your word? So teach us, challenge us, grow us, so we can meet Jesus when he comes in the clouds of glory. Amen. So let's open our Bibles to 2 Chronicles and chapter 7. Just about a third of the way through the Old Testament, about a quarter of the way through your Bible, is 2 Chronicles. And these books are letters. They're historical documents written about what was happening during the times of the kings and the earlier part of the prophets. And the verse we're dwelling on is verse 14 together. Which verse? Verse 14. We're just journeying through one text today. By God's grace, we'll get through that one text by the end. And the first lesson we're going to learn is that prayer is about a person. Can you say person? All right, let's read from the text. If my people, that's us, who are called by my name. Notice the opening statement God makes. He doesn't first say, I want you to do this, and then I want you to do that. First of all, he reminds us how we got here. You're my people, he said, and I called you not by your name, not by your reputation, not by your desires. I called you by my name. The same thing was said to Moses at the burning bush. And remember, Moses was a man who ran away. Moses was a man who had murdered someone else. He had forsaken God, but he was still a man who was called by God's name. Think about that for a moment. You're much more valuable than the immediate environment you're in. You are as valuable as the God who calls you. It's a bit like how sometimes you'll meet someone and they'll say, oh, you're so-and-so's son or daughter, are you? Oh, okay. And immediately they'll associate you with someone that you're connected with someone else's name. Now, granted, sometimes that's not the best reputation. Sometimes it's quite a credible one. But the point is, we should not be identified by what we've done, by what family we come from on this earth, by our own bank accounts. We can only be identified by the God who calls us, his name. The name of Jesus is the name that calls you today, the name that cast out demons, the name that raised Lazarus from the dead. That is the name which stamps freedom onto each of our lives still today. And that is the name which calls us to be his people today. Isn't that great news? It's the name of the Lord which we are identified by. So it's about the person. Prayer begins with looking to God. Check out here in Acts chapter 3 and verse 6. A few weeks after Jesus had left, and keep your finger in 2 Chronicles because we'll keep turning back there. You will know this story well, perhaps by a children's song. Remember the song? He went walking and leaping and how does it go? Praising God. That's what happened to this man who was healed here. Before he was healed, this is a statement that was made. He was lame from birth, this man. Then Peter said, silver and gold I do not have, but what I do have, I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. What did Peter have? He had Jesus' name. Peter had the identity marker from the Lord of heaven and earth. Peter had the identity marker of the man who lived, who died, and rose again. Our authority does not come from our nice building or from the money that we have or from the people we hang out with. Our authority comes from Jesus. So the same authority comes for each of us, church family. Prayer starts with a person. With a person. That's when prayer really gets meaningful. All right, let's come back to 2 Chronicles now and deepen into the text. The second lesson we're learning about prayer is that prayer is about penitence. Can you say penitence? Penitence is an old word that means I've messed up. I've got rubbish that needs dealing with. Penitence means simple repentance, confession. Looking at the text in 2 Chronicles 7, verse 14, after it says, my people who are called by my name, it says, will humble themselves. This is the attitude of God's people today. I find it interesting that so much of the time when we are striving to walk with God, our character, and especially mine, our character can totally miss the mark. Have you ever noticed that? We wear the right clothes, we say the right things, we look the part, and my goodness, our attitude is a shocker. We need the character of God. Will humble themselves. Later on in the text, it says, and turn from their wicked ways. Now, let's be honest here. We need God today. We need His help. We need His forgiveness. And we'll never quite reach a point where we've made it, you know. Yeah, it's been a few months since I last sinned. Not doing too badly right now. Yeah, right. We're waiting for Jesus to come for that to happen. And it's the perfect recipe too, because for now, we get to learn how to truly be grounded. In the Sabbath school class I was in this morning, we were talking about how a lot of the time when Jesus would teach, he wouldn't stand and be domineering like the scribes in his day. He would sit. And as a result of that, they would say, this guy teaches with authority. Now that's ironic for a guy who sits, but he learned what it means to live for God in a humble way. And may we be a people that when someone points to us or shares about this church, they say, yep, that is a humble church. They've learned what it means to put others before them. Humility literally means that other people become more important than yourself. And the great war of our hearts is that we want to be on top. Pride wants to win. That I've got to be the one sitting on the throne. But the heart of the gospel is when we realize how small we are in God's eyes and how much more important other people are too. Now, the good news is, if you are listening to this thinking, my goodness, I am useless at that, you're in good company, because so is the neighbor beside you, so is your pastor, okay? But the call is not to simply admit, yeah, I'm a sinner, I've got rubbish. It's to turn from your wicked ways. Can you say turn? Turn. Come with me to Romans chapter 2. And this is where the power comes with the rubbish that we have. I was talking to one of our members the other week, and he was sharing with me how he was known in his prime years for having the most vulgar language anyone ever heard of. Comes from a building site background, so that's like the perfect place to build up your language experience. And he said since he gave his heart to the Lord, this process has been echoing through his heart, through his language every day. And he said, it's amazing. I hang out with the guys every day of the week now. They swear their lives off. And God keeps my tongue controlled. It's not second language anymore. He's actually changed my tongue. This is what happens when we turn from our wicked ways. He actually starts growing in us. This is wonderful. Romans 2 and verse 4. Or do you despise the riches of his goodness, forbearance and long-suffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leads you to repentance? Talking about this word repentance here, penitence, about truly turning from your wicked ways. Now, in order to truly experience that, you've got to have the right motive. For example, if I was to come to God and say, Lord, please clean me up from my overeating. All right? That's an issue for me, by the way, if you didn't know. Lord, I need your help. I want to turn from that wicked way. And imagine this is my motive. I want to do it because I want to look skinny. Now, is God's goodness motivating me to turn from that wicked way? No. It's a personal goodness that I'm seeking there. It'll never work if you're turning from something for your own benefit. Motive is the key for a lot of things. The text says, the goodness of God leads you to repentance. So we learn two things there. Firstly, repentance happens when you've got the right motive. Secondly, repentance is a gift. Repentance is something that God does in us, not we ourselves. So maybe there's an area of your life that you sense God needs to fix, and it may not be an overnight thing. Maybe there's a relationship that needs healing. Maybe there's a habit that really needs God's touch of grace. Make sure the motive is right, and He'll surely work it out for us. All right, back to 2 Chronicles. We're still journeying through here. And this is where it gets really powerful. The third lesson is prayer is about, say it with me, power. Ever heard someone pray a sweet, gentle prayer, and you can sense that they just don't believe God is going to answer? Man, I pray those prayers a lot sometimes. Need God's power. The text says in 2 Chronicles, and pray and seek my face. God is calling his people who will learn what it means to burn the midnight oil in prayer. Think about your own personal life, family. Think about what happens in your day-to-day schedule. How much of a priority is prayer? And remember, you cannot get by someone else's prayer. Jesus, he got up a long while before daylight, and he went to a solitary place and prayed. We've got to do the same thing. And the great distraction of the enemy is he wants us to be too busy to pray. Wouldn't that be nice? No, there's too much on. I just don't have time for God. But the great call from heaven is, if my people learn about the person of prayer, learn about the penitence of prayer, and learn about the power of prayer. And I'm willing to bet that everyone in here knows of a story, knows of a moment where prayer was powerful. But isn't it interesting how they could just become experience? They just become a story instead of a living practice in our lives. May the people who know you personally grow to see you as a person of prayer. And bear in mind, prayer is not popular today. Prayer is considered silly in society. But if my people, may we be a praying church. Probably if there's one thing that I would say is a growing marker of Royal Oak Seventh-day Adventist Church, because we do a lot of things good, but a growing marker is we've got to learn how to pray. And notice, the text is not just talking about individual prayers, it's united prayers. When united prayers happen, God has given permission to do more. But we've got to be willing to pray. To pray. Turn to your neighbor and say, it's time to pray. When I was in Australia, I met a dear lady who came to me once, and she shared about an answer to prayer. Her name was Elliot, is Elliot, and a sweet, sweet, godly woman. And she comes to me and says, my husband, who I've been praying for 30 years, he now wants God in his life. Imagine that, eh? My husband, who I've been wrestling with God for, who used to mock me when I'd go to church, who used to create distractions when I would try and take my kids to Sabbath school, my husband now loves Jesus. Amazing, eh? Not long after that, he was baptized. This 70-year-old man who now had a broken heart for the Lord. And you know what he said just before he went under the water? Simple as this. I'd like to thank my wife who never gave up on praying for me. Maybe there's a person in your life and you just feel like your prayers aren't being heard as you're interceding for them. Maybe there's a personal struggle you have and you wish God could answer. Hold on. God is in the business of answering prayers. He's got the perfect time ready though. Now on that note, let's keep these people in mind over the month of October. Let's invite them along where we can, because this is the time that we're waiting for Jesus to come, the time where we need God's Spirit. Just an added note about this idea of power, church family. Before Jesus left, he said, you will receive power, but that power only came when the people were willing to pray. And it came in the form of the early rain of the Holy Spirit. Now we're waiting for the latter rain to come, just as a final shower would fall on a harvest to bring that final fruit. We need to be praying for God's Spirit too. Can you say amen? Now, I'm going to do something different here today. I'm going to ask us to pray right where we are in our pews this morning. And I know sometimes prayer is personal, but biblically it's also corporate. So I'd like us just to turn to our neighbor where we are and make sure no one is left out on your pew in twos or threes. And I'd like us to pray that God's Spirit will fill each of your lives. Pray for anyone else that you have in mind, but also pray that God's Spirit will be poured out on this upcoming month of evangelism. Can you do that? We need to be praying together. So just quietly with your neighbor, you can make it conversational or both, or offer a prayer each. Please just take time to pray now. And let's do that for the next few minutes, just quietly where we are. Let's please just remain quiet while others are still praying. So, Father, we thank you for hearing us today, and we claim your promise that how much more willing are you as our Heavenly Father to give the Holy Spirit to those who ask. So shower us with your rain, baptize us afresh with your power, we pray in Jesus' name, amen. Thank you all for doing that. Every night before our evangelistic meeting, we will have a season of prayer here at 6:30 each night. So if you're free, come and join us for this. Sabbath mornings, it'll be at 8:30 here. 6:30, 8:30 on Sabbath mornings. We want God's power. So let's keep this in practice. I wish we could do this every week, actually. Spirit of Prophecy tells us, do less talking, including preaching, and more praying. So let's continue to be a people of prayer. All right, final part of prayer from the text is, prayer is about a promise. Towards the end of the text there, this is how it reads. In verse 14 of 2 Chronicles 7. Then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. Notice God doesn't just say, I want you to do something. He finally says, and I'm going to do something in response. That when we meet the conditions of prayer, we give God permission to answer. So he says he will hear us. Wonderful news, eh? Secondly, he'll forgive our sin. Notice whose sin needs to be forgiven in order for God to do something in our city. It's ours. It's the secret things that we're not willing to tell anyone that have been holding us back for the years. It's the doubts that we hold. Perhaps it's things that we're not even aware of, and we need God to reveal them to us. Finally, he says, and heal their land. The change God wants to bring to our city, to our country, to our globe, it's not dependent on who the next US president will be. It's not dependent on who the next member of parliament will be here in our local area. It actually depends on you and me. The text says, if my people, if God's church will stand up in his name today, will learn the meaning and the depth of prayer in their lives, then I will heal their land. Interesting that the issues that are happening still in our immediate community, guess who's responsible of them? Ouch. We are, according to this text. So let's stop pointing the finger, watching the news, waiting for God to do something. Let's be the change, be the praying church he's called us to be. If my people. There are two finer lessons I want us to learn from this. Number one, don't talk about what to do. Let's not plan prayer, talk about amazing news about prayer. Let's do it. Amen? Enough discussing and reflecting about prayer. Let's just do it. Secondly, the heart of prayer is not about being on time. It's not about what you're saying. It's about what's happening in here. If your attitude is still caught up on your own world or in what someone else has done to you, you're making a great big barrier between you and God, between us and God as a wider church. So let's do it. Secondly, let's ask God for the right attitude. Two of the key nuggets for making this possible. The story is told of a woman who found herself with an empty cupboard, just a few crumbs and drops left in the fridge, and a great big family to feed at home. So when she came to the local grocery store, she came to the attendant behind the cashier and said, "Sir, can I please make a purchase today, and I'll pay you back next week?" The man looked at her and said, "Sorry, ma'am. We only do those bill accounts for people who have already done credit references with us. We just can't provide that for you." So, keeping in mind her hungry husband and children back home, she came even closer and said, "Sir, please, is there any way that you can let me take something home?" "Sorry, ma'am, I just can't help you." Then from one of the aisles, a man overhearing the conversation approached the woman and said, "Can I pay for your food? Can you put it on my account, sir?" The woman was really excited when she heard this. But the man behind the cashier desk still said, "Sorry, you can only get your own food. You can't get food for her." And he said, "Hey, I'm going to pay for it in the end. Come on, let me do this." And he said, "Fine, I'll cut you a deal. Whatever you have on your shopping list," and he was being a bit tricky here, "as long as that weighs up to the amount of shopping that you want, then I'll let you take whatever you like." You know, sometimes they would have weighing scales in the old stores. So she thought about it, quickly pulled out a piece of paper, and she scribbled on it, "Okay, you're on." After she opened her eyes, she placed the piece of paper on one side of the weighing scale. And as you can imagine, it didn't move, because paper weighs nothing, near to. And then she hovered around the store, quickly grabbed a bottle of milk, a loaf of bread, a few other bits and bobs, and by faith, she brought them to the counter. The man looked at her, shaking his head, took the bottle of milk, and when he placed it on the other side of the weighing scale, he couldn't believe it. It didn't move. A milk bottle was being balanced by the same weight of this little piece of paper. She handed him the bread with a big smile on her face, and he put the bread beside it, and he couldn't believe it again. The bread and the milk still balanced with the little piece of paper. Finally, he put the last bits there on the weighing scale, and still, it didn't move an inch. "Ma'am, what did you write on that little piece of paper?" he asked. As he pulled the paper off, he looked at it, and it wasn't a shopping list. It was a prayer. "Dear God, thank you for providing for all of my needs today. Amen." You see, it wasn't the weight of prayer that balanced out for all of the groceries that were sitting on the weighing scale. It was faith that was holding on to a simple prayer that was lifted to heaven. Not paper, the prayer of faith. And let's bear in mind that we serve a God who too offered a prayer of faith there at the cross. The prayer of faith said this: "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do." The prayer of faith also said, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And because of that, we don't have to feel forsaken today, because Jesus went through that on our behalf. So may the great power of the price Jesus has paid be a good enough reason for us to be a praying church. If my people. Now in closing, I'd like us to sing a simple tune together. A song which simply asks for God's Spirit to take a hold of our lives. So stand with me. We're going to sing it without any instrument. And we'll sing it twice through so we can get used to the tune.
Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Break me, melt me, mold me, fill me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me.
One more time.
Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Break me, melt me, mold me, fill me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me.
We praise you, Father, for the promise of your Spirit, but recognize today that we cannot live and still be led by your Spirit. We've got to die. So for each person here, for every family represented too, and for those who couldn't join us, we ask that you will come and refresh our lives with your Spirit. So much so that we will become a people that if the Holy Spirit was removed, that nothing would happen. So as we return to the missionary field now, we pray that your rain will fall on us, will fill us, and will use us. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In Jesus' name, let us all say, amen and amen.